Let me take one moment, if I could, this morning, and before we have a chance to open God's Word, and remind you that we are gathering together here inside of this place this evening for a time of celebration. We are meeting back here at 5:30, and I want to invite you to come and join us, not only to recognize Kristen's ministry during the last several years in the life of Sharptown Church, but also to celebrate her family, and have the privilege then of praying a benedictory prayer over them as God is preparing them for their next step in the area of ministry. And so tonight, once again at 5:30, all are invited here to come and celebrate Pastor Kristen, her family this evening. Come back and join us, if you will, for a time when we have a chance to gather together. I've been asked to tell you, some of you have asked, can I bring a potluck dish? Can I bring something for this evening's celebration? The answer is no. How do you like that? You can just show up. So that's a pretty good deal. And so I want to just invite you this evening one more time. I'm trusting that's already on your calendar. let me, if I could, take you back just a couple of Sundays after Easter. The day of Pentecost. We've been thinking upon and about that particular section of Scripture out of Acts chapter 2. And just to remind you, and as a refresher, I'd like to go ahead and put these very familiar words up from Luke's account of the Pentecost experience as the Holy Spirit comes in fulfillment of a promise upon a group of people. And so let's put that first slide up if we could. And I'd like to invite you one more time, read with me, and we want to go ahead and just be reminded of where we have been and the things we've been thinking about, and then we'll use this once again as a springboard this morning for our thoughts together in preparation for a time of communion. So when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place, and suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. And they saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came and rest on each of them. And all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit. And they began to speak in tongues and as the Spirit enabled them. And we spent a good bit of time walking through the three particular steps that took place here on this Pentecost Sunday, and finally have concluded with the coming and the arrival of the Holy Spirit. We mentioned that whenever we think about this particular passage of Scripture, and whenever you read about this in from commentators or people who write about Pentecost, you typically run into three words, several more certainly, but three at a minimum, that have to do with Pentecost. We said there words that begin with P, and because Pentecost begins with P, they're a little bit easier to remember. And we said that certainly when we talk about the idea of the Holy Spirit living inside of a person's life, that has to do, and we speak about aspects of power. We mentioned the idea of presence and also proclamation. And so let me go ahead once again and just remind you of these three words. Last Sunday, we talked specifically about the second word, the word about presence. And we used some statements from John Ortberg's book, that God is closer than you think. And we made this statement about the idea of presence, that the story of the Bible is not primarily about the desire of people that want to be with God. Instead, the story of the Bible is primarily about God's desire to be with people. And we thought for a few moments about how interesting that is, that God has a greater desire to be with you than you do to be with God. And I would suggest that if you pulled out your calendar and you had the opportunity somehow to put your 168 hours of last week on the screen, we probably might be able to illustrate that God's desire is greater to be with you than our desire is to be with God. And again, trying to be as reductionist as we could around this idea of presence, Ortberg makes this statement, which is a helpful one. Let's go go to the next slide if we could. And he said that the most frequent and the most central promise in the Bible is this: I will be with you. I will be with you. And so with a sense of certainty, we concluded our time together last Sunday with the general understanding that we have a God who wants to be with you, who wants to be with you. And if you think about that for just a moment, and you pause and consider once again, the idea that when we, as people who are Christians, have a unique claim that no other world religion makes, and that is this: that God can actually come and be part of our lives. We use language like this inside the church, that Jesus lives inside of our hearts, or accepting Christ into our hearts, or that God wants to be in your life. And so, a fulfillment of this statement and this great promise that God makes, I will be with you, and we're reminded that his name is Emmanuel, which means God with us. And that was easy for the disciples to understand for 3.5 years as Jesus walked among them. But then when Jesus was making preparation to leave, he gathers his disciples together and he said this: that I'm not going to be with you much longer. You're not going to be able to visually see me, he said. You're not going to be able to visually see me. And he makes this promise to them and makes this promise to us. Not only I will be with you, but let's go to the next slide if we could, out of John 14. But you know the Holy Spirit. You know the Holy Spirit. He lives with you and he will be in you. He will be in you. Now friends, I want to say, generally speaking, you can take me to task on this, but I'm going to go ahead and say, generally speaking, the distinction about the Old Testament and the Holy Spirit and the New Testament and the Holy Spirit is that in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit comes upon a person, and we've used this image before, comes upon a person to do a specific task, for a specific thing, for a specific feat. God comes upon a person, but then in the New Testament, it's as though it gets turned over and language changes, and language says this, and Jesus is the one who introduces this idea that I will be in you. In you. Old Testament, let's put this on tight. Old Testament upon, New Testament in. I will be in you, says Jesus, and I will not leave you by yourself. I will not leave you by yourself. And I would hope, now, maybe, you know, it's against understanding, but I would hope that perhaps some of us this week thought about the idea, no matter what circumstance we found ourselves, no matter what we were doing, that God was with us. He did not leave us by ourselves. I will come to you, said Jesus. So we walk with him, and he walks with us. As Psalm 23 reminds us, even in the darkest and the most difficult of all circumstances. So, presence. So I want to take one more step today. Power, presence, proclamation, and I want to talk with you a little bit about maybe one of the clearer illustrations in the New Testament about the idea of the Holy Spirit and proclamation. So come with me to a very familiar section of Scripture in Acts chapter 4, and I would like to walk with you through a very specific passage of Scripture today, and itemize and identify that understanding about the Holy Spirit's role inside of our life in the midst of proclamation. Now, Acts chapter 4 follows Acts chapter 3, in which John and Peter were involved in a miraculous healing. And so we pick up the story that the priests and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. They were greatly disturbed because the apostles, Peter and John, were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. They seized Peter and John because it was evening, and they put them in jail until the next day, because many who heard the message believed, and the number of men who believed grew to about 5,000. So let's leave that slide there on the screen if we could, and I'd like to walk through that with you just a minute. Notice, if you will, the opposition to what Peter and John were saying about Jesus. The priests, or the professional religious people of the day, they were threatened by the message and by the healing that took place by Peter and John. The captain of the temple, the chief of the temple, also a little bit intimidated by what was happening by Peter and also John, and then the Sadducees. Now, that's an important thing to mention here in the Sadducees in chapter 4. Notice the Sadducees, they're in line number 2, and then come down about a little bit more than halfway, where it says they were proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. You see, the Sadducees did not believe there was any such thing as resurrection, and so they were inflamed and they were hostile to what was going on. The New Testament language inside of it was written in Greek, and so if you were to look closely at these words, there is this understanding that they burst into them with kind of a hostility. They were upset about the message that was being presented. One commentator says that they were stomping up to them, and that gives me a visual that I can kind of put in my head, you know, that these three opponents of Peter and John stomped up to them because God is at work in their midst. It's also fascinating when you begin to look at the movement of the early church and how things begin to unfold, specifically under the influence of the Holy Spirit, the number of persecutions that take place. And this really is the first one that's mentioned inside of Scripture. There are many, many more, and some for extended period of time. Early church historian said that there are 10 seasons of persecution inside of the first 3 centuries of the early church. Jesus said, it shouldn't surprise you. In John 15:20, he said, if they persecuted me, then they're going to persecute you. 2 Timothy chapter 3 says, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will receive some form of persecution. And so the Bible reminds us here that there is this confrontation from those who certainly were speaking out and preaching about Jesus Christ. And so as they are speaking about Christ, they come and they want to go ahead and take them into custody. One author whose last name is Wax, Trevin Wax, he said this: when we say we want to be the hands and feet of Jesus, we must remember what happened to the hands and feet of Jesus. Well, that's an interesting way to think about that. Perhaps maybe not so much inside of our culture, as we know that taking a stand for biblical values, in fact, does cost us something. The story continues on the next slide, as we have a chance to read. The next day, then, the rulers and the elders and the teachers of the law, they met in Jerusalem. Annas, the high priest, was there, and so was Caiaphas. And you might recognize those names, right? Because they were part of the contingency of people who crucified Jesus and were part of his crucifixion. John, Alexander, and the others of the high priest's family, and they had Peter and John brought before them, and they began to question them, and they asked them, by what power did you do this? By what power did you do this? Remember that Jesus, the resurrection, becomes front and center for the disciples. Peter and John, we read just one slide earlier that said that they were speaking about Jesus Christ and the resurrection. Let's go to the next slide if we could. So Peter stands up, filled with the Holy Spirit, and I want to just underline that phrase. Peter stands up, filled with the Holy Spirit. That God's presence is very real inside of Peter's life, and he is yielded to him exclusively inside of his relationship in Jesus Christ. And he said to them, "Rulers and elder of the people, we are being called into account today for an act of kindness shown to a man who was lame and are being asked how we healed. Then know this, you and the people of Israel, it is in the name or by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, you crucified him, God raised him from the dead, and this man stands before you healed." We spent a couple of weeks during Sunday school thinking about this being the central theme inside of the book of Acts. That the resurrection of Jesus Christ not only is the validating miracle inside of the New Testament that Jesus is who he made the claim to be, but also that there is enough evidence inside of the New Testament and beyond that can validate an actual physical resurrection from the dead. All they had to do was to produce the body, and the movement known as Christianity would have dissolved. All they had to do was produce the body of Jesus Christ, and the movement would have dissolved. But they could not produce the body of Jesus. That the tomb was empty, and the reality for the disciples, specifically Peter, and then also for John, was that they saw the resurrected Christ. That's who we proclaim. That's why we stand here. And that's who has raised or has healed this man here in the midst of our conversation. Notice, if you will, that the Bible is very clear to talk to us about the link that comes with the Holy Spirit's movement inside of their life and the proclamation that was happening inside of that moment. I don't know that we think enough about this inside of our culture and inside of the work of the church, about the Holy Spirit speaking in us, speaking through us to a world and to our friends who need to know who Christ is. Not only to our friends, but also in the midst of standing, in the midst of opposition. And so, tell us how you did this. Tell us how you did this. It's in the name of the resurrected Christ that we stand here before you. And so they preach and speak about Jesus Christ. You crucified him. God raised him. Let's continue on in the story out of Acts 4. Jesus is, said Peter, the stone that the builders rejected and has become the cornerstone. Now this is an Old Testament imagery out of Psalm 118. It's also, you'll recognize, this comes from another gospel as well. But the idea that Jesus is the cornerstone. We know that to be true inside of our life because of a song that we learned maybe a little bit earlier that said about a wise man who built his house upon the rock instead of sinking sand. That's what that implies, that a cornerstone is an immovable object that we build as the foundation upon. Salvation, then, says Peter, is found in no one else. And there's no other name under heaven given to mankind which you must be saved. Notice, if you will, that included in the idea of the resurrection is also the idea that Jesus Christ is the only one who provides salvation inside of our lives. And the proclamation to stand before the same people that crucified Jesus, because they are empowered by the Holy Spirit, they stand without any hesitation at all and make the statement that salvation is found in no one else. Now, you're going to think perhaps today that's an exclusive term, and that's an exclusive idea, and I want to say to you that's exactly right. That's the reason why Peter and John stand in the midst of a culture that says that there's no one else, or there's nowhere else we can find salvation except in Jesus Christ, and the church hasn't moved off of that since that day. Jesus becomes the only way, says the Bible. Jesus makes the statement that he is the way, he is the truth, and he is the life. And so as a result of that, we find salvation inside of his name. And they saw that Peter and John had courage. They realized, I love this kind of clear sort of picture that Luke presents about Peter and John, that Peter and John were unschooled. They were ordinary men. They were astonished that they took note that these, let's go to the next slide, that these men had been with Jesus. They'd been with Jesus. Now that is the unique distinction here in the midst of our conversation. Being able to have confidence in the midst of our proclamation doesn't have anything to do with who we are. It has to do with who we're spending time with and who lives in us. Oftentimes, I've had the opportunity to talk with people, and people make the statement regularly that, you know, I can't speak about Jesus. I just typically live my life for Jesus. And I want to say that that's true, that the Holy Spirit transforms our actions. The Holy Spirit transforms our life. God transforms what we prioritize. God transforms how we order our lives. But I also want to say to you that there is going to come a time when you're going to have to name the name. There comes a time inside of situations when we're going to have to, perhaps, as Peter says in the New Testament, give an account for the hope of glory that lies within us. It's fascinating here that, surrounded by people who probably were kind of looking down at Peter and John, not just because of the way they were dressed, not just because of who they knew that they hung out with, but thinking that they did not have a formal education, thinking that they certainly shouldn't be standing in one of the higher courts in the land. No, no, not at all. They're concerned because Peter and John's life had been shaped and formed because they had spent time with Jesus. The application question almost asks itself, doesn't it? Is that true of our lives in the midst of what we do during our week-to-week walk with Christ? And so just only hours after Pentecost, in a short window of time, here were Peter and John standing. The Holy Spirit is enabling them. They are filled with God's presence. And it's so apparent that they recognized that they had spent time with Jesus. Now, I want you to notice, if you would, please, that it doesn't say that they noticed they were filled with the Holy Spirit. It says that they were noticed that they had been with Jesus. And that is because inside of Scripture, the role of the Holy Spirit is never to exalt himself. The role of the Holy Spirit is singularly responsible to exalt Jesus Christ. And so even the Holy Spirit in Peter's life, even the Holy Spirit in John's life, points to Jesus. And so when they look at Peter and John, they see Jesus. And that's the role of the Holy Spirit inside of our life, one of his responsibilities. Since they could see the man, there was no dispute This guy could not walk. Now he's standing right next to them. The healing has taken place, and there is not a thing that they could say. And so they ordered them, listen, withdraw from the Sanhedrin. And they conferred together, and they said, what are we going to do with them? What are we going to do with them? They've already spent a night in jail. What should we do with them? If they continue to heal in the name of the resurrected Christ, we're going to have a problem. Because after all, we just crucified him, and now they're claiming he didn't stay in the grave. What are we going to do about this circumstance? Everyone living in Jerusalem knows they've performed a notable sign. Now, I want you to pause for just a moment and notice the language. Everyone living in Jerusalem. Now, this is a subtle way that Luke helps us understand that all they would have to do to go ahead and disqualify this movement, all they would need to do would be to go to the tomb that Jesus was buried in. That's all they would need to do. They were in Jerusalem. If they just showed up at the tomb and recognized Jesus was in the tomb, this would all fall apart. But the problem is, everybody in Jerusalem understood that when they went to the tomb, it was empty. Everybody in Jerusalem is going to understand there's something happening here, and we cannot deny it. We can't deny it. Here he is, standing right next to Peter and John. He has been healed. He has been healed. And the person they claim healed him is the guy we crucified just a few days ago, and the tomb is empty. Now that's an amazing circumstance for them to have to stand in the midst of, and Peter and John are not backing away from that. You have to be quiet, says the leaders, says the Sanhedrin. Let's continue on. You have to stop this thing from spreading any further among the people, and we must warn them to speak no longer to anyone in his name. We must warn them to speak no longer, not to live in his name, to speak in his name. To speak in his name. Understand, here is a very clear representation about the idea that the Holy Spirit enables us in the midst of our witness when we talk to other people about Jesus and what he has done inside of the world, but also inside of our life. Inside of our life. They called them in and they commanded them, not suggested to them, they commanded them, don't speak anymore. Don't speak anymore. Don't teach anymore in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John replied, which is right in God's eyes, to listen to you or to him? You be the judges. And then this sentence, which I want to think with you a little bit more about this morning. As for us, we cannot help speaking about what we have seen and what we have heard. We cannot help speaking about what we have seen and what we have heard. What's in us comes out of us, says the New Testament, says the Old Testament as well. We can't help speaking about what God has done. You crucified him, God raised him, we saw him, and we can't be quiet about that. Filled with the presence of God's Holy Spirit, they stood as people who were uneducated, ordinary people, and they understood something happened in their lives. They had been with Jesus. Let's look at this a bit more closely if we could. Let's go to the next slide. You remember these words just a few chapters earlier in Acts. Well, by the way, just a real brief commercial. Mike Peterson and Brian Cowan are going to be speaking and teaching about the early church for the next couple of weeks in Sunday school. I want to invite you in that capacity. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses. Yes, by how they lived. Yes, by how they lived. Yes, by how they prioritized their life. Yes, by how they gave themselves away. But the implication here is something just a bit more, but also verbally. You will speak, you will speak, you'll receive power. God's Spirit's going to come. You're going to talk to other people and be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Let's go to the next slide. Let's go one more if we could. And here is what they said. If you're going to go ahead and transliterate this inside of, right out of the Greek language, for we emphatically are not able not to speak. It's called a double negative, okay? We are unable, emphatically are not able not to speak. This is really important, they said. We have to speak. God's changed our lives. There are a couple of other moments inside of history really quickly that I want to point to where this has happened. Let's go to the next slide. In the midst of the Protestant Reformation in church history, you can reach all the way back to the 1500s where Martin Luther makes the statement against the Roman Catholic Church, and he says this as he stands in front, this is an interesting term, the Diet of Worms, the Council of People, the Council of Christians at that time, the Council of the Roman Catholic Church. I cannot and will not recant anything, for to go against conscience is neither right nor safe. Here I stand. I can do no other. So help me God. Do what you want to with me. I am not moving off of this reality and this truth. God's grace and grace alone brings salvation. Not the purchase. Not the purchase for my sins. Not God's grace and God alone. And then 100 years later, this guy, let's go to the next slide if we could. This book was perhaps for a long, long, long time in history, was the second best-selling book next to the Bible in the history of Christian literature, written by a guy named John Bunyan. They threw him in jail for writing this book, Pilgrim's Progress, and they kept him there for 12 years. And so then they stood in front of him, he stood in front of them, and they said, listen, John, are you going to stop preaching like this, writing like this? And John Bunyan says, if you let me out of prison today, I will preach again tomorrow by the grace of God. If I lie in jail till the moss grows on my eyelids, I will never conceal the truth that God has taught me. Here I stand. Even if the moss grows on my eyelids, I will not speak anything other than, we, said John and Peter, we emphatically are not able to not speak about Jesus. Because you see, that's what happens inside of our life whenever God's presence comes to live there. That's what happens inside of our life. We kind of begin to talk to other people about what God is doing inside of our life. He comes in. He comes in. And he lives inside of your life and inside of my life. And so our language changes. The things we talk about change. The resurrected Christ becomes central inside of our thoughts. Now I want to go ahead and invite us this morning, invite Kristen back to the front as we uncover the elements for communion, and the ushers wait upon us this morning. When I was growing up at Second Methodist Church in Millville, we ran through the same liturgy, for communion, and as the ushers come forward and as we uncover the elements, I want to invite you to look at the communion liturgy that I was accustomed to while I was growing up. Let's put that on the screen. There is another slide in that deck. There we go. I'd like for you to read with me these next two slides, and then I just want to highlight one thing before we share communion together. Read with me, please. We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the same Lord, whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to partake in the sacrament of thy Son, Jesus Christ. Stop there for just a moment. This is what's been given to us in the history of the church since the resurrection of Christ, that when we share in the broken bread and in the cup, we invite Jesus into our lives. Keep reading with me. That we may walk in newness of life, that we may grow into his likeness, and may evermore dwell in and... There you go. Did you pause to consider that when we share in the broken bread and in the cup, that the very thing that Jesus promised to do by his presence is to come in your life? I want to leave that up for a few moments if we could. And as we share this time, perhaps you may offer this prayer, Lord, will you continue to create and shape inside of my life a new life? May I grow into your likeness, and will you be very real in my life? Our kids are going to come back into the auditorium, and they're going to come and share this time of communion as the ushers are going to wait upon us. If you're gluten-free, we have a cracker for you this morning. We'd love to go ahead and have you raise your hand. Nice. I love this congregation. I'm laughing because someone behind you was gluten-free, and I missed him. And so Jerry Ruff stood up and was doing like this. Don't forget. Jesus took the bread and he broke it. And he said, "This bread is my body, which is broken for you." Before we have the opportunity to eat that, be reminded of the very visual imagery that by eating that, you are enacting the prayer that Christ would live in you. Take and eat it.
As Jesus shared the meal with his disciples, he picked up the cup. And he said, "This is my blood shed for you. There's a new covenant." He said, "When you gather together and you share in this meal, remember that." Friends, as we share in this meal today, and I invite you to drink the cup, the blood of Jesus for the forgiveness of our sin, may we remember this sacrament and that he lives in us. Take and drink.
It's the presence of God inside of our lives that enables us to give us confidence, to give us the ability to assist us, to empower us, to have the privilege of speaking then to others about what God has done inside of our life. It's for this reason that we read a bit later inside the New Testament where Paul makes this statement, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ." I'm not ashamed. Because of the resurrected Christ, because of his transforming power in my life, I am not ashamed. Let me invite you to stand with me if you will. Let me close with this encouraging word out of Peter's letter that says that we as Christians, we as the people of God, we who make the proclamation that Christ has come to live inside of our life, we who have prioritized by faith walking with Jesus, we should always be ready to give an account for the hope of glory that lies within our hearts. Always be ready to give an account, because the Holy Spirit inside of our life enables us, empowers us when we proclaim what he has done for the world and for us. Will you pray with me? "And now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before his throne with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, to whom honor, power, majesty, and dominion belong now and forevermore. Amen." Go in peace.